AGM in a company called CAMS. So I have worked for companies like TCS, Cognizant. So first of all, I'm a 2008 AGPM pass out. And I have worked for companies like TCS, Cognizant, Latent View as well. He's working, and currently I'm working with, I work for India Property, and I work for, I'm currently working for a company called CAMS. Just to give an intro, CAMS is in a back office for mutual funds. So they have the, collect the complete data about 60% of mutual funds. So I'm working and managing the data science and analytics team there. So I'll be taking you through the topic called the recommender system. So before starting, I wanted to get an idea, like, what's your view or what's your idea about recommender system? What are some places where you have seen recommender system? Maybe, yeah.
Recommender
system
is recommendation.
Correct.
Amazon.
Facebook.
Facebook.
Yeah.
Facebook, LinkedIn, any other? So yeah, so
YouTube,
correct. Yeah.
Google searches.
So any e-commerce, any .com site that you can think of, right? Any e-commerce site, .com site. I think if it has at least some level of maturity, it will have a recommender system. So what's your idea? Why do you think there is need for a recommender system?
Discovery.
Yeah, discovery.
Make you stay on the site for
a little more time. So engagement, customer engagement.
Cross-sell.
So there are two components here, right? One is the buyer, one is the seller. So in the end, the buyer could be anyone who is, whatever the business model is, there will always be a buyer and seller. So here the buyer could be just listing an open free website like Google, or it could be a website like YouTube. And there will be a seller, so a person who, if we take the example of YouTube, a person who creates a video and puts it on, sorry, let's take him as a seller. The person like us who visits YouTube will be the buyer. And then what's the purpose of a recommender system? Like she said, make people engage more. And so YouTube has a different model. The more you engage with the system, the more better it is for YouTube. Let's take an example of a Flipkart. So you go, I generally buy books on Flipkart. So I buy a book, say A. So what happens immediately, you see a recommendation pop in between. So if I buy a book related to some technical book, there will be a recommendation related to another technical book on a similar topic. Like people who bought this also bought it. And then what happens is, the sales, like some people say, sales increases by X percent rather than just give. So that's good from the seller side as well as from the buyer side. From the buyer side, you have choice. You have choice to buy different varieties of things. I'm sure you all would have realized that many times you would have discovered new things which you had never seen before. Right? For instance, when you are buying a book, get a recommendation, you would have never seen that book before. But you find it interesting, you explore it more, and then you end up buying it. So that's just an example of or application of recommender system. So this is some of the common examples that we see of recommenders. From LinkedIn, you see people also viewed, right? Or you would get recommendations about, do you know this person? You can connect or skip that person. So that's as far as LinkedIn is concerned. Flipkart. So I looked at a particular product on Flipkart, a shoe, and it gave me so and so recommendation. So from by looking at it, I looked at a particular product that has similar in color and price to these products. So if you see, they all fall in about 1,500 rupees. So. And another interesting story as far as recommendations are concerned. So there was a particular book called Into Thin Air. So this book was about mountaineering. And the beauty about this book was that in turn made another book called Touching the Void as a bestseller. So the person who wrote the book Touching the Void, he wrote it around like several decades back, and hardly anyone knew about the book. But this book called Into Thin Air was a very famous book. People started purchasing, and as and when they got the recommendations called Touching the Void became famous. This was written several decades back, and it became a bestseller as well. So in the end, it turned out that both were written about mountaineering, trekking, etc. So that's a very interesting case of the success of recommender system. So So if, just a question to you all, if I were to ask someone of you to build a website and say, build a recommender system, what's one quick and easy way that you recommend products? Like you are...
Put it on Excel.
Sorry.
Put it on Excel and try to link various things.
Right, but what will you recommend if you have 1,000 products with you? Correct. So again, that's not user specific. That is... Yeah, so that's...
Yeah.
But again, it depends. You need to have a history about the user. It has to have a context.
Characteristics
means attributes of. Correct. So all that will come into this second category called personalized recommendation. The first one that I have said, right, handpicked items, top trending items. You would have seen this when you visit websites like Make My Trip or Flipkart, etc. So when you visit those websites, you will be seeing at the top deals for today, top 15 deals in fashion, top 50 deals in books, etc. Right? So you would have seen Make My Trip, another 2 days the offer will get over, etc. So those are like top trending items. What do you think is the problem with the first two that I mentioned, handpicked and top trending?
So there's no user preferences. Basically, they are putting in the process.
Correct. That's one more problem apart from that. Now, that's something called as long tail.
Mm-hmm.
So when you have, say, 1,000 products, and if I say I recommend only top 10 or top 20, what happens to the remaining ones? So there are 900 products that are lying idle without any consumption. So that is one of the problems with the first two cases.
What's the name, is it?
Long tail.
Long tail.
So just like in the distribution, you have a long tail.
Basically saying that 5% of items anyway gets sold, 95% of the other items, how do you discover that is this?
And then you want people to discover your items, right? And then that's the purpose of recommendations. So that's where the third point, personalized recommendations, come in. So there are two things here. One is they cover the vast array. So if you have 1,000 products to sell, out of that 800 or 900 products would get recommended to some user or the other. In the end, at least some of them will be sold to users. And another thing is it will be personalized. So I mostly buy books or I buy some electronic items from Flipkart or Amazon. But when I go online and if I am recommended some fashion item like shoe, etc., I hardly have bought any shoe online. Then they won't get my engagement, right? So that's where personalization comes into picture. So two of the key most famous algorithms, and I think some of you would have heard the first one, collaborative filtering. And that's what I will be taking today. And I will be also walking or giving some details on how we build a recommendation system at one of my companies. So again, I don't want to get too technical, but at the same time, I wanted to cover what the basic essence of collaborative filtering. So let's say we are on a e-commerce website like Amazon, and we have four users. Four users are listed there on the left. So it's Ajay, Ram, Sudha, and Vinay. And at the top row, you can see four books. So one is Da Vinci Code, Two States, Lost Symbol, and Immortals of Minerva. So these are famous books, and all those four users have rated all those four books. So some of the cells are empty. So what that means is either they have not read the book, or they have read and not rated the book. So either case, I mean. So this is where collaborative filtering comes into play. If you see, if you take the case of Ajay, so he seems to have, can you interpret, get some details on what is the kind of, what is his taste in terms of books? Based on his, so he has rated Da Vinci Code well, he has rated Lost Symbol well, or at least decently, and he hasn't rated Immortals of Minerva.
Fiction.
So at least you can get an idea that
fiction.
Or at least both of them are from the same author. So at least that's a quick interpretation you can get visually from this. Based on that, if I were to recommend say Lost Symbol to any other user, who do you think I should most probably recommend to?
Sudha.
And Vinay as well.
Or it could be Vinay as well.
Yeah.
Why? Because he has a high rating for Darwin Darwin. Right? So that this in essence or in a very high level is what collaborative filtering tries to do. What it does is it takes users it takes the entire set of users. So if I have rated 3 movies or 3 books, it takes my ratings, it looks at other users' ratings, it sees the difference between me and them. So in case of Ajay, it will calculate what's the difference in rating between what Ajay gave and Sudha gave in Dalvichiko. So it will be 0. So essentially that means that both have 0 distance in terms of similarity. So it will recommend other things that Ajay like to Sudha or Vinay. So that's in very simple terms what collaborative filtering is. Again, this is a very deep topic. You can look up about it as well. So what I said was something called Euclidean distance. You would have come across in trigonometry mathematics. There are a lot of ways by which you can calculate user similarity. Right? So again, there are two types of collaborative filtering. To put at a very broad level, there is a user to user and a product to product. Again, user to user, product to product is two sides of the same coin. So just like we find similarity between users, you find similarity between products. So in the end, product, finding the similarity between products is easier. Because in the end, you will maximum have like what, 1,000 products in a system. Whereas users in an e-commerce site could be running for several lakhs or several millions. So in terms of books, the genre could be something like fantasy, fiction, humor, etc. But in terms of human beings, there are so many levels of this. It's a very complex thing to understand that is. So that's why product to product is an easier thing to find. And one more thing I want to talk about is something called explicit and implicit rating. So in Amazon, you would have seen people would give ratings on the website, right? So those are explicit ratings. You are saying, I like so-and-so products on the website. There's something called implicit rating. So let's say, what are some examples of implicit feedback you can think of?
Time spent on a page.
Correct, time spent on a page.
Or maybe writing a review but not putting a rating.
Yeah, correct, to some extent, yeah.
Sending a
or
feedback.
User engagement, like she said.
Sending a feedback to the...
Correct, so feedback. So that shows user engagement, is interested.
How many times is coming back to the same?
Correct, yeah. So time spent on page, number of times someone clicks on something, right? So only if someone is interested, you will click on a link. So those are all implicit. You don't rate anything on 1 to 5. But then you implicitly state that you tend to engage with it. And there's one more interesting problem called cold start problem in recommendation. So what cold start problem means is, let's say in the previous case we saw 4 books, right? So we recommend some set of books to other users. But what if, let's say, 2 cities, no one has read that book and it's just come into the system yesterday. So that's called a cold start problem because no one has rated the book, no one has liked the book. So you need something to get started and start recommending it to. So unless there is no rating, that's called cold start problem. So collaborative filtering suffers from some of those problems. And second is content-based system. So again, it has, I will just explain how on a broad level how it works. The 4 books that we took earlier, Da Vinci Code, 2 Cities, Lost Symbols, etc. You have something called attributes. So if you would have seen, Da Vinci Code, Lost Symbol was written by Dan Brown. And also Da Vinci Code and Lost Symbol are written by a foreign author. So people generally like reading some foreign author novels. And there is this book, 2 Cities, written by Chetan Bhagat. And they got on some other by Ramesh Tripathi. So at the top you see author, Dan Brown, author, Chetan, journal. So you see that's a 1 indicator wherever it's applicable. The Da Vinci Code and Lost Symbol will have a 1 and other 0s. So what this says is, you're trying to map the attributes, features of a product. And then you will recommend based on the features, you'll be recommending products to people. So people who prefer or read Dan Brown books would be recommended those corresponding things. So this is content-based system. So you may be wondering what's the difference between the two. Right? Collaborative filtering, as you must have understood, is more user-based. It takes user similarity. So it's just we are a room of 20 people and I like a certain book and he likes a certain book. It will see who else is liking that book, right? And it will recommend to those people. So it's more user-based and crowd-based. Whereas content-based is purely based on that particular product that you are looking at. Right? It doesn't matter which other user liked it or not. So if I as a person like Dan Brown books, I'll only be recommended Dan Brown books or something associated with it. So we built a recommendation system at one of my previous company. So that was an interesting project. So this was for an online internet company. And so the situation was, there was a vendor who was working with the company, and he was providing a web service through which we were rendering the recommendations. So we got about 10% of our leads. So it's called leads. So let's take a website like Suleka. You may like a certain product and you will put a lead saying this is my name, this is my number. That's called a lead. So about 10% of the leads were coming through recommendations. So that was the service provided by external vendor. So our agenda was to do away with this vendor and build our own recommendation system. So it was quite an interesting and challenging project. We evaluated a few tools and for the first time I built a recommendation engine. But we in the end went with Hadoop and Amazon AWS, which is a cloud provider. So again, the input, it was a pretty simple algorithm. It was collaborative filtering plus content. It was a hybrid algorithm that we built. And so if you see the line number 3, that was the form of input that we gave. So it was very simple. If a user, like I said, implicit feedback, right? You are able to follow? Or, I mentioned about implicit feedback, right? So in our case, we had to take implicit feedback because we didn't have any rating system on our website. So let's take, we have a product X and a person clicks on that and puts a lead. So that means that he has a very high interest in that product. So we give a rating of 2. If a person does not put a lead, but he clicks on that product, he just views it, we give a rating of 1. Then we give a rating of, it's by implicit it's 0. If a person does not view or does not put a lead. So this is the assumption we took in terms of, we track the web blogs and we track the customer's experience on the website. Based on that, we track products and who are the people who have viewed what, who are the people who have put leads. So that's how we, so that's the input format we gave, line number 3. So we did two things. One is recommendation personalized to a user. So if I have looked at product AB, okay, let's say I have looked at the shoes in the past, I will recommend new shoes for this customer whenever I come in. Second is product based. So if I look at, you know, I've seen 3 or 4 shoes, but suddenly I go and see a electronics mobile item, mobile, then I will not get any shoe recommendations. I'll get only mobile on the page, mobile recommendation or accessories. So that is item based recommendation. This is user based, customized recommendation. So there are two things we did there. And we did, so you may wonder how did I test it, right? It's a big system. We get about like 3 lakh leads in a year. So you may wonder how did I test it before, ensuring that I am better than the other person. So we did a testing, like if we have an entire data set, like 100 or 1000 users, we took about 5 or 10% as the test data. And we built the system on the 90% trained data. And we predicted it on the test data. So entire data is in the past. We subsetted it and we predicted. So we got a decent accuracy. There are some parameters we looked at and we got a decent accuracy. And then we rolled out in production and it performed pretty well. So we looked at two things, click-through rate. So whenever a person, if there are 10 things you show to a person and you whatever you click, that's called click-through rate. After you click, if you put a lead, it's called conversion rate. So we tested this for about 1 to 2 months. And then the metrics were pretty good. We did A-B testing, like someone said. We did A-B testing of our algorithm versus theirs. So we tested on like 10% traffic, then we tested on 50-50 traffic. And then finally, when we were convinced, when we clearly beat them, we rolled it out on the entire data.
This is only for recommendations for on your site, right? So if someone Googles, it goes to your competitors and
this only on our website. So these are some of the other tools that I can think of. So I said Hadoop Mahout, that's a machine learning platform. These are other tools that good in terms that have recommendations. Collaborative filtering and other algorithms inbuilt. So Apache Solr, Apache Spark, Python has some inbuilt algorithms, R has some inbuilt algorithms. So yeah, it was a very interesting project that we did, and I would say this is learning such kind of interesting systems is not very tough. Like I said, we used AWS. which is a cloud-based system. So, so many, you get so much of cloud, the free cloud space these days on AWS, Google, you can test this out with your infrastructure. So, yeah.
You use AWS because it gave you better infrastructure as in the memory. Sorry, getting a bit technical, but yeah. Why go for an AWS when you can have your own machine or something? I just saw that you were able to use graph up there along, right? That they can open those upward, but I'm being able to use it on my own machine. So why go for an AWS when you they do offer?
The data was of a decent size, I wouldn't say very huge, but it ran into a few tens or hundreds of GB. But again, we needed infrastructure, as you said, we needed infrastructure to set up. There was time constraint. So again, infrastructure setup, it needs approval, cost approval from the senior team. The internal team has to be aligned, they have to get the infrastructure in. So that is a big task. So in interest of time, we went for AWS. AWS comes with everything set up, ready-made. All your Hadoop, Mahout, everything comes set up. So maybe, as you said, over a period of time, we can have it in-house as well.
Is it possible for you to give me some kind of reference or I mean later?
Yeah, sure.
There
are good references.
So, how you went about building the system? Because my knowledge is a bit limited, but when you say Hadoop, the general tendency is to think about something like a very complex type of data, like what you find on Facebook or Twitter. But when you're giving up links and recommended systems, the assumption is that you'll be getting proper links which you can easily, it's structured in a better way. So. I don't see how Hadoop would be applicable there.
There is a module. So Hadoop as such has definitely a lot of projects. So there is Quick, there is Hive, there is Mahout, Impala. So Mahout is a machine learning project. So for me, that itself was a discovery when working on this project. I was looking at other systems to build. Someone said Mahout is a project within Hadoop. That has very good machine learning projects.
Inbuilt algorithms, right?
Correct.
But I'm just going on and on about technical stuff. Again, use GraphLab, right?
No. GraphLab, that was just a recommendation. I didn't, other tools that you can build.
Okay, but again, these algorithms don't give uniform results. When I use an algorithm from GraphLab, and when I use it from some other package in Python, say, NumPy or something like that, the actual output differs.
It depends on the internal implementation, how it is.
So is there a way to go about choosing a certain algorithm?
So mostly the algorithms, I suppose they will all be standard, collaborative filtering. But yeah, there will be some intricacies within Hadoop, Mahout, there are some specific intricacies within it. So we may have to look into that. But I think most of these serve the purpose. I would say Solr is, at least the first two are open source. At least you can implement all this without any major cost.
Again, open source.
In fact, all of these are open source. Or there will be a problem, it has memory problems, memory issues. So we didn't go with
that. Just a question on the infrastructure of the project. So basically, you have a machine learning machine. AWS does all the storing and.
So this AWS is not a storing purpose. Okay. AWS has a plenty of capabilities. If you don't have an infrastructure for a company, I can set up a virtual machine in AWS. And it has Lambda. Lambda has a feature and plenty of, in essence, is one more feature which does the analytics portion of AWS. So they have integrated entirely storing. I think storing is like,
everything has a module. Storing
is a module. Database is a module.
There's a CPU, there's a hard disk.
Everything is integrated in AWS. It is very cheap and very cost effective and very easy to install.
It's like you can connect to a computer, it's like using your own computer. All you need is you are connecting to a remote machine. You will have all the hard disk, RAM, everything assembled somewhere, and you can use it just by connecting it.
Yes.
Whatever time you use, right? 1 hour or half an hour, that's the only time it will be built.
More tasks will be provided for the Kinesis, Lambda feature, and the AWS IoT extraction. But all other things are very cheap and very less possible.
It's not so far, it hasn't happened frequently in AWS.
What happened frequently has happened.
No, it has happened with AWS sometime, but not with us.
No, I think that's covered.
It happened sometime.
People going to the cloud, right? That encryption is being done. So that is an encryption layer which is in line with the conference.
Because what we do is we have some people who are working here. Sometimes it's our most of the data is in AWS. So we just have a thing, but we are working on a particular project.